Today on BRStv, an update on the E170. You've been asking for the details, so today a specific focus on the Bulk Pharma Hybrid Balling Method. Tropic Marin and BRS work together to bring you something affordable, flexible, and solves real chemistry problems in our tanks. If this tank looks like a success to you and something that you want to emulate, we'll show you how this approach to two-part solves three major challenges reefers face: salinity, pH, and a flexible approach to trace elements. Not only is it easy, but it's also one of the lowest initial costs, highest quality options out there. All that's coming up. Hey, I'm Ryan, your host of BRStv. The E170 is really coming along. I'm asked all the time how we manage major, minor, and trace elements in this tank. The answer is a Tropic Marin Balling BRS Bulk Pharma Hybrid Method, meaning that we're following that balling method on the E170, but use BRS Bulk Chems to make it more affordable and get a larger boost to tank pH. This tank has been up for 18 months now and gone from tiny 1-inch frags to this. The approach is certainly producing desirable results. Bulk Pharma two-part, one of the lowest cost reliable methods of achieving it. So far, the only additional cost of this hybrid method is a few bucks a month in Tropic Marin's Part C. Looking at this closer, the hybrid approach that you'll see here today is one of the unique approaches that acknowledges and accounts for the excess sodium chloride issues common with most two-parts. It also solves the elevated CO2 levels and low pH levels most reef tanks have, and a flexible approach to minor and trace elements. I'm going to explain what the hybrid balling method is and how it solves those issues in just a moment, but first, many of you already get the value, see the types of results that it produces, and just looking for the recipe, so here it is. Part A, or the calcium part, is 2.5 cups of Bulk Pharma calcium chloride, or one pre-measured tear strip pouch, between 0 and 330 milliliters of Tropic Marin's Coral K Plus Trace 1 with enough water to make up a gallon of solution. Adding the Trace K to the calcium solution like this will add barium, boron, chrome, cobalt, iron, copper, manganese, nickel, strontium, and zinc to your Bulk Pharma 2-part, making it a more complete solution. Part B, or the alkalinity portion, is 2 1/3 cups of Bulk Pharma soda ash, or one pre-measured pouch with 0 to 330 milliliters of Procoral A Trace 2 with enough water to make up a gallon of solution. Adding the Trace A to the alkalinity will add bromine, fluorine, iodine, lithium, molybdenum, selenium, and vanadium as well. Part C, Tropic Marin sodium chloride-free sea salt mix, 4 scoops and enough water to make up a gallon of solution. The Part C is the heart of the balling method solution to maintaining balanced chemistry for the long term, something we'll get to in just a moment. At the end of today's video, I also have some mixing tips that make this process a bit more precise and easier as well. In this recipe, I'm sure you noticed that range is 0 to 330 milliliters of the Pro Coral traces added to the respective two-part jug. So why a range and not a specific number? The ability to adjust this is one of the clear benefits of Tropic Marin's approach. I spoke with Tropic Marin and they suggested using 0 for that first year to year and a half of the tank, meaning the initial grow out period. During that period, a reasonable water change schedule with a good salt like Pro Reef is an adequate solution for most new tanks. After that, if you have a fairly low demand tank, consider 80 milliliters of Pro Coral Trace per gallon of respective two-part, medium demand 160 milliliters, and heavy demand the full 330. The reason for scaling this up or down is something that we'll dive in today. There's some considerations here that I personally haven't addressed before with previous approaches. The flexibility here is valuable. As to the E170, we're exiting that first 12 to 18 months now, and so far have not started dosing any of the Trace 1 or 2 on the E170 yet, and currently at that zero end of the range. I think most people will be inclined to agree that the water change approach to trace elements has worked up to this point. Looking at this tank, you might wonder why I would start now, but I am starting this week. I'll share more details as to why in just a moment, but I believe chemistry solutions need to evolve with the tank. One of the greatest tragedies in our hobby is the ideal solution for year 1 or 2, or the grow out stage of the tank, might not be the same thing as year 3 or 4, or the lifespan of a robust tank full of larger colonies. Without clear guidance as to why, it's a fairly big hurdle for most reefers to consider changing what is currently working to solve or preempt tomorrow's problem or the next stage of the tank. So if all you came here for is the recipe, that's the Pharma Balling Hybrid 3-part calcium and alkalinity solution. But if you want to know how this Pharma Hybrid Balling method addresses and accounts for the excess sodium chloride or salinity common to all two parts, elevates the low pH common with most tanks and living spaces, has a flexible approach to trace elements that matches your specific tank, and still works with the BRS calculator using the standard Bulk Pharma concentrations and drop downs, Let's dive in. Now that you know how to make it, how does the hybrid balling method solve the challenges discussed? Starting with the foundation of the balling method, excess salinity. We just released a master sodium chloride episode, which dives deep into that relationship and supporting science and how this works. It's probably the best resource for understanding, but it's also nearly 20 minutes long, so I won't repeat the entire thing. Here's the most basic summary. All two parts have the salinity issue from the excess sodium from the sodium carbonate or bicarbonate and excess chloride from the calcium chloride. As the excess sodium chloride build up, it's essentially the same thing as adding small amounts of sodium chloride or table salt to the tank every single day, which will obviously raise the salinity over time. Water changes will mute this point to some degree, but eventually we will need to dilute the tank back down, remove some salt water, and replace it with fresh water to get the salinity back down. When we do that, the sodium chloride and salinity will get back in line, but everything else will be diluted and fall below ideal levels. It's fairly easy to independently raise calcium and alkalinity back up, but everything else is slightly depleted. Not a huge deal today or even in that first year or two of the tank, but imagine what years of that process looks like. There's an inevitable path here. A good water change schedule will push it out, but we can do better. In this case, better is both easy and inexpensive. This is where the balling method in part C, or the sodium chloride free salt mix, comes in. Part C is basically the same as the salt that comes in the Pro Reef salt bucket, except for there's no sodium chloride, calcium, or alkalinity. Dosing this alongside the two-part means this. Rather than only elevating sodium chloride with your two-part dose, nearly every element gets slightly elevated, likely only a few percentage points and not something that would affect the health of the animals. However, when your tank raises from 35 to 36 ppt salinity, and it comes time to dilute it back down to 35, most of the tank's elements will fall back down together. So regardless of how you dilute the tank with manual removal, salt water and fresh water replacement, or the net result of your skimmer removing salt water and your ATO replacing with fresh water, or even just mixing your water change water to a slightly lower salinity, part C is what maintains the long-term balance of your tank's chemistry. Just as a reminder, this sodium chloride or salinity issue is not the type of thing that would affect most tanks in that first year or two. This is a cumulative effect of small but continual changes to chemistry over multiple years, a much harder to identify issue. Knowledge on how this works and related solutions will go a long way, but confirmation via ICP tests are probably the main way someone would actually figure this out. However, if we acknowledge the nearly inevitable issue up front and select a solution, we can avoid it altogether. Like everything, the balling method isn't absolutely perfect, but short of massive water changes, which are likely more expensive and more work, the balling method is the best solution that I've found for this chemistry challenge that most two-part users will eventually face. Before we move on to the next challenge, I'd like to demystify maybe one of the most commonly misunderstood components of the balling method. That's whether or not part C is a method of trace element replenishment, and it's not. Because part C is a pro-coral salt mix without the sodium chloride, calcium, and alkalinity, it inherently means you are adding the rest of the major, minor, and trace elements to the tank, and it would seem like at least a partial replenishment solution. This is the reason why it's not. When inevitably you dilute the tank back down to fix the salinity issue, you're going to remove these elements in near equal ratio. So I think it's most helpful to not think of part C as a trace element solution. Part C's only purpose is to maintain balanced chemistry in an environment where excess sodium chloride is added daily and needs to be accounted for. Trace element addition will be done by adding pro-coral trace 1 and 2 directly to the two-part, and something that we'll cover in just a moment. Next challenge also solved. We just released a master hydrogen and pH episode, which covers the issue of excess carbon dioxide in our homes, how that reduces the pH of our tanks often to that 7.8 to 8.0 range, well below the ocean's levels of 8.2 to 8.3. And then how that excess acidity can result in 50% slower growth, brittle coral skeletons, slow to no coralline algae coverage, and stress-based mortalities. That's why the Pharma or balling hybrid method swaps out that predominantly sodium bicarbonate alkalinity solution the standard Tropic Marin balling method uses with BRS Pharma sodium carbonate. The alkalinity portion, or the standard breakdown of part B of Tropic Marin's balling method, is roughly 83% sodium bicarbonate and 17% sodium carbonate, which creates a solution which has close to no effect on the pH of the tank. The near neutral pH effect makes it a great option to dose by hand, make larger changes all at once, and generally easier to dose. All things that make it a great option for something sold on a retail shelf where guidance on how to use it best is harder to convey. However, anyone watching videos like this one is a knowledge seeker and represents a different tier of reefer who collects and applies knowledge to a different level of result. Once you know the harm of depressed pH and increased acidity in the tank and what it causes, or the benefits of solving that, it's hard not to want to achieve that goal, and sodium carbonate-based two-part is one of the most popular options, sometimes the entire solution. The only caveat with a sodium carbonate or soda ash-based two-part is it shouldn't be dumped in all at once by hand, and the results are best achieved when it's dripped in slowly to a high-flow area of the tank with a DIY dripper, but more commonly, a dosing pump, and preferably directly into an inexpensive powerhead to disperse the pH effect rapidly. That caveat of slow addition with a high pH two-part is likely why most retail two-parts use a lower pH solution, which can be dumped in by hand all at once. Now the third and maybe the most interesting challenge addressed, trace elements. The Balling Method's approach to trace elements is unique because not only does it add trace elements, but they also acknowledge that trace element uptake is different between different tank types, coral species, and stages of the tank. Acknowledging that allows for an evolutionary approach. When I spoke with the team at Tropic Marin, they shared, like most two parts, trace element consumption is directly tied to calcium consumption, and adding the full 330 milliliters of trace one and trace two to the respective two part jugs does that. So if trace element consumption is tied to calcium uptake, why isn't there a consistent ratio rather than a range of 0 to 330, and why would anyone ever dose less than 330? This is essentially just an acknowledgement that when your tank is brand new with no or limited corals, the nutrient uptake is often just different than a multi-year robust tank. Coralline algae and precipitation and pest organisms like algae, dino, cyano, and diatoms consume and deplete elements in very likely different ratios than a multi-year tank full of large coral colonies. So trace element uptake and replenishment in this newer tank environment is different, and you may just be feeding undesirable organism growth as well. However, maybe more important, an acknowledgement that in a low demand tank with minimal coral, a reasonable water change schedule with a good salt mix is an adequate solution to trace elements. At least for that first 12 to 18 months, it's just not a good use of time or money. So they suggest adding 0 A and K trace elements for that first year or so. Where you fall in that range before you start adding trace elements is a judgment call based on how many corals you have in your tank. Just for reference, E170 is about 18 months old now, and just now we're gonna start dosing trace elements. The E170 went from a tank full of tiny 1-inch frags to this in a year and a half with only dosing calcium chloride, soda ash, and Tropic Marin's Part C. So if this is successful so far, why change it up now? As element consumption scales up, there's an inevitable reality that water changes are going to become an increasingly ineffective solution at managing trace elements. Understanding the inevitable chemistry issues, I can choose to wait for it to become a problem and then treat that issue, or I can preempt it and skip the problem altogether. This is part of what I earlier referenced as a difference between the most successful paths that get us through those first 2 years of grow out and how they may be different than the solutions that carry us from year 3 to 10 of robust coral colonies with rapid uptake and related more rapid changes to overall chemistry. As to how much of these trace elements to dose and the difference between 0 and 330 milliliters, the E170, as of today, I'm gonna start with a quarter of that max and work my way up over time, meaning 80 milliliters of Pro-Coral K plus trace 1 to the calcium portion of the two-part and 80 milliliters of Pro-Coral A trace 2 to the alkalinity portion, effectively shifting my bulk pharma two-part to a more holistic approach to element and chemistry management for the E170. We can watch the results over the years together. I'll likely scale up over time towards that 330 milliliters per gallon of two-part. Most people do this based on a visual assessment of the corals, but the most engaged may send in an annual ICP test just to confirm the tank's chemistry trends. Something wise to do regardless of the chemistry solution that you use. If you are an ICP user, that allows for another refinement here that most other two-parts don't have. If you see a group of elements that are rising or dropping, you can simply adjust trace one or two independently. I don't want to go chasing numbers, but some flexibility to match your specific tank's uptake is obviously a benefit. As I promised earlier, I do have some direct guidance on how best to mix all this together. First, it's always best to mix your two-part in an open-top container like a pitcher, where it's easy to mix the salts while you pour them in. Second, we're making a gallon of solution here, not a gallon plus 330 milliliters of trace solution, which would be more, and dilute the calcium and alkalinity. Best way to do that is fill a container 2/3 full of RDI water, dissolve all your powder, add the trace element solution, and then top off to a gallon, mix, and then pour into your dosing vessel. For those of you looking for direct guidance, I believe everyone will benefit from dosing the Part C of the hybrid balling method. So if you're not doing that, feel free to start today. The chemistry supports the decision, and honestly, it's so cheap and easy to do, it's not worth debating. As to the Pro Coral Trace A and K trace elements, if you're taking this in that first 12 months and you have a decent water change schedule with good salt, I wouldn't use any. After that, if you have a lower demand tank, consider 80 milliliters of solution for each respective gallon. A medium demand tank, consider 180 milliliters. For reference, I think the E170 is currently what I'd call a medium demand tank. And if you have wall-to-wall coral, work your way up to the 330 milliliters. I'll certainly let you know where the E170 lands in the end. Third, while four scoops in a gallon of Part C doesn't look like much, it can't be concentrated more than that. Because of that, you have to dose twice as much Part C as you do A and B, meaning if you dose 100 milliliters of each calcium and alkalinity solution a day, you'll need to dose 200 milliliters of Part C daily. Fourth, everything you heard today is related to the BRS Pharma hybrid balling method. If you want to use the standard balling method, make sure to follow their directions, which have totally different measurements and a more dilute formula based on sodium bicarbonate. Thanks to the team at Tropic Marin for helping us develop this hybrid method. And for anyone who wants to really dive into the how sodium chloride affects a reef tank and the most reef nerdy take that we've ever done on this, here is the Master Chemistry series on sodium chloride.